Tonight on the Henry Rollins Show, outspoken musician and provocateur Peaches joins us to discuss her new album and why she refuses to give in to censorship in any form. And Ringside will join Heidi May for an exclusive musical performance. Don't go anywhere. Cheat. Some of us go big. Ashley Simpson lip-synced her crappy song on Saturday Night Live, and all she got was another record in the stores and half her nose removed by a surgeon. Some of us go really big. Weapons of mass destruction. They're right over... whatever. When Donald Mumsfeld was asked, what the fuck, he said, there are known knowns. These are things we know that we know. There are known unknowns. That is to say, there are things that we know we don't know. But there are also unknown unknowns. There are things we don't know we don't know. Oh, come on. Some who cheat can be downright dangerous, like adults who disguise themselves as young people and troll MySpace for the teen hookup, or corporate chiefs who bilk their own employees out of millions of dollars. More run-of-the-mill cheaters include students who cut and paste off the internet and hand it in as their own term paper, athletes who take steroids, hackers, lobbyists, even the good Chief Justice Roy Moore, who used the cover of night to sneak his corny Ten Commandments statue in front of the courthouse. You're not gonna keep church and state separate on his watch. Fucking pathetic. And then, there's published authors like James Fry, Kavya Viswanathan, and J.T. Leroy who either lied, plagiarized, or never even existed. They were all ultimately exposed as trampling the truth as effectively as Karl Rove trashes any Viet vet who gets in President Bush's way. All these books are selling right now. Cheating is cool. It's expected and encouraged. What do you think all those "What Goes On in Vegas Stays in Vegas" ads are all about? Corruption oozes from our pores. It's a human thing. China isn't the most dominant world power because they play by the rules, just as America isn't where it is because we asked, pretty please can we have this, to every Native American we encountered. Thankfully, most of us would rather lose honestly than cheat to win, like some people do. Joining me now is Peaches, one of the most outspoken and daring musicians performing today. She's established herself by singing, producing, and performing most of the instruments on her two albums, Teaches of Peaches and Fatherfucker. With the release of her new album, Impeach My Bush, Peaches continues with her outspoken and uncompromising music. Peaches, thanks for being on my show.
Hey, it's a pleasure.
Much appreciated. First question I wanted to ask you. To the not yet initiated, what could people expect from a Peaches performance?
Everything. 500% energy. Just like in there, in the pit, with the people. You know, just climbing the walls. Just totally singing, screaming, doing everything. Engaging. You leave like, yeah, that was like a Kiss concert, or like Van Halen, or yeah, you know? And then you're like, wait a minute, there was nothing there. There was no big light show. There was no heavy explosions. There was no band.
Right.
What the, like, you kind of have that moment of like, have I been had? No, it's a real, that's it. That's all you need, you know? You just need that energy, that like giving of 500%. Because to me, you know, people hide behind stuff, you know? I love electronic music and my sounds are electronic a lot of the time. But I hate knob twiddlers because they just think that their music is so important that they have to look down and twiddle knobs. It's like, no, I make that music. There, yeah, I made it. Now let's do it. You know?
Cool.
So I just wanted to bring a, like, the punk element into it. Just like, this is what you need. You need to sweat. That's about it. You know?
I do.
Yeah, great. I know you do.
Is there a sexual element to the performance?
I think there's a sexual element to everyone's performance. And it's funny, people are always like, Peaches is so sexual, you know, sexual, this or whatever. It's like every part of you is, you know, a part of everybody is the way you express yourself. You're exuding your sexuality, your being, your expression, you know? So, yeah, there is a huge sexual, and people find it more sexual, I think, because I'm just giving it all. Like, by the end of the show, yeah, I'm in a bra and little shorts, because it's hot up there. It's like, you know, Iggy Pop, he doesn't wear a shirt because he can't be bothered. It's like, he's sweating, you know? What am I going to do, wear a full Victorian outfit? Like, yeah, you know, I'd rip it off in two songs, and then people would be like, that's so sexual. And I'd be like, no, it's just like, you know?
So just by nature of being up there and being yourself 500%,
yeah,
there's an incredible sexuality to it.
Yeah, I think what people's perception of sexuality is, and what I'm doing is sexual, is also changing. Some people are like, I don't think that's sexual at all. That's disgusting. Because I'm just like, kind of, they see me as aggressive, and then, you know, I'm wearing little shorts, and they're like, oh, too much. And some people are like, totally think it's a come on, you know?
Yeah.
The best comment I've ever had from my live act is this guy said to me, like, I laughed and had a hard on the whole time.
Well, what else? I mean, you've played with, you've toured, you know, you have your own audience who I'm sure is like front row, can't wait to see you.
Mm-hmm.
But you've opened for other bands.
Yeah, well,
that's always gonna be a mixed bag.
Yeah, I opened for Manson.
And how'd that go?
Well, I got spit on every night, and they'd just be like, what the fuck is that guy?
Huh.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I've always admired Marilyn Manson. I just think, you know,
yeah.
I think he's really sharp. And I don't know his audience.
Yeah.
I would hope they would kind of be like him, where they would go like, oh, cool. You know, I like this. It's liberating.
No, every night I was going like, you're not, you know, black sheep. You're sheep in black. But it was fun. I had fun because, like, you know, in London, they'd be throwing bottles at me. But they'd be like, wouldn't be glass bottles, because you weren't allowed to bring glass bottles in. So they'd just be throwing bottles at me, and like, my dad was a pitcher. I know how to, like, you know, throw. I was telling them they all threw like girls. And then I had a plan, because I had a huge, like a water cooler bottle. So I was like, yeah, throw the bottles. We would do bottle fights for like 40 minutes, bottle fights, singing, bottle fights. And then at the end, I just brought out the big bottle, and I was like, oh yeah, I got the biggest bottle. So I just, like, you know, make it part of the performance, you know, make it part of whatever it is. Then that's what I really love to do, no matter what the reaction is, whether it's good or bad, just play off that and, like, you know, bring it back to what it is right there.
You're saying good or bad, a reaction is, it's all good.
It's all good because it's a reaction. And so you have to deal with that. You can't just, like, you know, shove reactions under the carpet.
Right.
You know? That's where problems happen. That's where things go wrong. You have to confront them.
Right.
You know, see where they go.
Let's talk about your music and your message, which is, you know, there's no holes barred with you. It's very strong.
Yeah. I definitely have a message, but I think it all stems from, like, music-inspired things, like my love of hip-hop and classic rock.
Right.
But what have I been singing along with? Big-legged woman ain't got no soul? Why am I singing along with that? Because I love that music, and it's just like, why am I singing along with that?
Mm-hmm.
I think people should sing along with this lyric. They should sing along, they should say two guys for every girl. Instead of singing along with Busta Rhymes. No, you could, I mean, sing along with Busta Rhymes and say, you know, your ass is so big, put the club in your ass, but then say, the tent is so big in your pants, it's gonna bring my friends for a dance, you know? I'm trying to even things that I hear in music already, but they're, I just try to flip them.
Like father fucker, motherfucker.
Exactly. That's exactly the point. Or saying shake your dicks.
Yeah.
Because there's like a million songs that say shake your tits. And I feel bad for guys because...
So you're trying to help us?
I am trying to help this.
Men need a lot of help.
They do. You know, women have had sexual revolution, but men really haven't. Straight guys really haven't had a sexual revolution.
But we're having a pretty good time, though.
Yeah, no, you're always having a good time.
Struggling as we do. We're still turning up pretty good for us.
Oh, no, but I mean that in all sincerity. I want to help men. I think they should feel comfortable shaking their dicks. Like, we sure feel comfortable shaking our tits. It's fun.
Yeah, I've never felt a compulsion to shake my...
It sticks out like tits, so, you know, it shouldn't be a problem.
I should be so lucky.
Yeah.
What do you think some of the misconceptions are about you?
The misconceptions of me is that I'm like a dominatrix, I'm just a slut, I'm not a musician. You know, but I like misconceptions. I think it's funny how people project things onto me. That also tells me that I have some kind of reaction and I'm confusing to people, which I think is important.
I think people are confusing to themselves.
Exactly.
And you kind of let that play out for
them. And that's like, I don't want to be confused. That's why, you know, that's where people follow blindly. Mm. That's where you get, you know.
Well, yeah, it gets you into a bit
Bush
of trouble.
Bush administrations and stuff. You just go like, okay, I'm scared. Let's follow him, you know.
So what's the message behind the title of the album, Impeach My Bush?
I like to always give a kind of double meaning to things. So I also, you know, I'm the only one who can kind of say impeach because my name Peaches. Yeah. So I always wanted to call an album like Impeachment, like maybe like my last album or Greatest Hits or whatever, you know? So I just thought, I'm also saying, if you don't know me by now, just like censor my pussy, impeach my bush, so.
Well, the song Fuck or Kill. I heard the song, I've seen the lyrics. Let's talk about that song.
Yeah.
I really like where it's coming from.
That's kind of my updated Make Love Not War.
Right.
Yeah. I'd rather fuck who I want than kill who I am told to.
Yeah, I really like that lyric. Just I think, you know, America's in a very difficult place right now.
Yeah.
And, you know, I've said to people at many college campuses, when the going gets rough, the average get conservative.
Yeah.
And I've seen it in this country,
you
know, this kind of gentle or not so gentle swing to the right where sane people can be talked into a lot of things at 3 a.m.
Yeah, that's really scary for me. That's why on my whatever level I'm doing it on, I always want to question power. I always want to question authority, you know?
Well, that leads me to my last question. What can Peaches teach us?
Peaches can just teach us to like really find out who we are and just really be that person. It sounds totally corny, but it's so true. I think we spend our whole lives trying to find our who we really are. And if we're gonna be afraid of ourselves, there's gonna be so many blocks to that. And we're gonna accept a lot of crap and we're gonna be part of the problem.
In a day and age when so many musicians can't wait to sell out and suck up to the highest power, the fact that you're doing your thing while saying fuck you to all of that, I really admire it. I'll always defend it.
Thank you very much.
Right on.
Appreciate it.
Coming up a little bit later in the show, an exclusive musical performance from Ringside. But first, another installment of the IFC Soapbox.
My name is Scott Ray, professor of ethics at Biola University.
My name is Peggy Kelly, and I'm a pediatric chaplain.
I'm Richard Deem. I'm a medical research scientist.
I'm Sansara Taylor, an initiator of the World Can't Wait, Drive Out the Bush Regime movement.
I'm Grant Albrecht, and I'm a patient advocate for stem cells.
My name is Nick Mikulicic. I am a member of a Los Angeles County Bar Bioethics Committee. Stem cells can lead to new cures, to new treatments, to new drugs. And it can prolong somebody's life and give them a better quality of life.
I disagree with embryonic stem cell research. I believe that embryos are human persons in a very early stage of development, and we don't sanction killing human persons in order to benefit others, no matter what the benefit is.
Stem cell research, it's a pre-embryonic form, and they're not formed in a woman's body, they're formed in vitro, in a petri dish. And they can never become a human being.
I'm against embryonic stem cell research because I think it's morally incorrect to destroy human embryos.
I grew up singing in the Methodist church choir. So I try to be understanding of people whose religious ideologies make them wary of stem cells. But I think the big problem is people are basing very strong opinions on very little information.
I just don't think that using embryos is morally okay.
You can have your personal beliefs, but if you go and start having that make decisions over what research gets funded, what policies get passed, what science gets suppressed and distorted and censored by the government, then you're moving towards a dangerous theocracy.
There are several scientific reasons why human embryonic stem cell research either will not work or will be overly expensive in terms of trying to do patient care.
To me, it's not a question of human life or an embryo's life. It's a question of real human lives or cells in a petri dish.
In a sane, critically thinking society that wasn't run by religious fanatics, there would be no controversy. People would celebrate a breakthrough like stem cell research and the horizons it could open up.
About 10 years ago, they told me, just hang in there a couple more years and stem cells will be ready. Well, I'm still waiting.
Color me ignorant, but I've only recently discovered a good option for parents to abandon their child that doesn't involve the highest bidder or secretly switching apartments. What you do is ship your budding youngsters to the deep wilds of Upper Maine, where they will live in an area haunted by the ghosts of lost Canadians. It's summer camp, and it's an essential time for your children to learn the skills that a middle-class child stuck in the woods needs. Skills like weenie roasting, social exclusion, and the twin arts of wedgies and Indian burns. It's also a time for children to have what educators and mafia enforcers like to call a learning experience. What they're supposed to learn is beyond me, but what they actually learn are lifelong fears of communal showers and the lower bunk. Seems like a great investment to me. You know, kids really grow up when they figure out their parents' true priorities. Mom and dad want a summer without you so they can go on a Caribbean boat cruise with a bunch of like-minded, experimental, and mature swinging couples. Hearing that'll grow a kid up. Anyway, I was so impressed by the camp experience that I started jonesing for one of my own. I figured if there's such a thing as band camp, math camp, labor camp, space camp, and campy camp, there must also be an adult camp. Well, as luck would have it, I got into some legal trouble recently, and I just found out that I have a bunk reserved at Guantanamo Bay. Fun! Now, I've heard there's a little light hazing for the newbie campers, but the weather's beautiful, and the counselors are supposed to be really accommodating. I can't wait to participate in some high-stress position sing-alongs. Well, happy camping! And now, here's Heidi May with an exclusive musical performance from Ringside.
Thanks, Henry. As an unsigned artist in LA, a daytime job is a necessity, and Scott Thomas has tried them all. Limo driver, roofer, baker, and even clothing designer. But with good friend and collaborator, Baltazar Getty, he stayed focused on the music. And 24 hours before being evicted from his home, he got the call he'd been waiting for his whole life. Here to perform the song Struggle off their self-titled debut album, we welcome Ringside, Uncut.
Check with
Thank you again to my guests, Ringside and Peaches. Before we go, with the release of Voices from the Frontline, a hip-hop album written and performed by troops currently serving in Iraq, this week's end credits go to Bill Mauldin and Barry Sadler, two enlisted men who captured the spirit of the common soldier. Bill Mauldin was a World War II infantryman who penned cartoons for the military's newspaper. His irreverent illustrations of dog-faced grunts were less than amusing to General Patton, who threatened to charge him with dissent. Fortunately for Mauldin, his comics were popular with troops in Europe and citizens at home, both of whom appreciated his undaunted look into soldiers' everyday lives. Barry Sadler wrote the album Ballads of the Green Berets upon returning home wounded from Vietnam. Berets topped the album charts in 1966, embraced by a country desperately searching for patriotism. However, his songs were devoid of any overt political message and meant only to serve as a gritty and honest tribute to the comrades he left behind. Because I don't think anyone could claim that it feels like wartime in the U.S. these days, take a listen to Voices from the Frontline. Perhaps if more of us understood what our troops are going through, we'd be less apathetic to our president's belligerent foreign policy. Thank you again for watching. We'll see you next time.